Nothing to stop this being the best day ever. Nothing to keep us from where we should be. I wanted the world, but you knew better.
If you didn't know it, that's you too. That's you too. Track 6, Finding God on your iPod 2018, now in its 10th season. The artist is you too. It's their 5th appearance on Finding God on your iPod. They are the all-time champions. In 10 seasons, they've been on now 5 times. That's about every other year. That's about right. That's U2. I don't have to talk about them. You know about U2, the biggest band in the world. And they've been the biggest band in the world since the Joshua Tree album. That was 31 years ago. So they've been around a long time. They've been around as a big-time band for a long time. 4 guys from Dublin, you know, Dublin, Ireland. They're all Irish. Bono, Edge, Adam Clayton, Larry Mullen Jr. They're Christians. They're believers. I think I could make a case that every song that U2 has ever recorded is a Christian song. I actually think I could do that. I don't know when the world's going to figure out the biggest band in the world is just a bunch of Christians kind of singing about Jesus but not being real explicit about it. That's just the way it is. Well, in December, this past December, they released their 14th studio album, Songs of Experience. It's the follow-up to the 2014 album, Songs of Innocence. And what they're doing there is they're just stealing something from William Blake, the great poet, who in 1792 released a book of poems that he illustrated himself, Songs of Innocence and Experience, would deal with the nature of the soul in these two realities of innocence and experience. And so they borrowed that from Blake for the title of their album. In some ways, I would like to use the entire album for, maybe we could just sit down and have a listening party and I'll just, you know, comment, you know, ever so often in between songs. In some ways, I would like to base the sermon on the entire Songs of Experience album. I think of it as the album that we need right now. I was so happy when it came out, and I remember listening to it for the first time and paying close attention, and I've listened to it, you know, probably a couple of hundred times since then. It's songs of hope, love, light, offered in a dark and troubled time. The topics that they touch on, I mean, there's always this theme of Jesus kind of lurking there, being the Savior of the world, but they touch on themes like mortality, marriage, bigotry, political turmoil, the Syrian civil war, the refugee crisis, things like that. There were five songs that I considered using. Lights of Home, Get Out of Your Own Way, American Soul, which I think is my favorite song on the album, The Blackout, and Love is Bigger Than Anything in Its Way. In fact, Love is Bigger Than Anything in Its Way is what I planned to use for months. And then at the last, I changed my mind. And what I decided to do was give you two songs, the opening and the closing songs, the quiet opening prelude that you just heard, Love is All That We Have Left, and then the closing lullaby, which is entitled 13, because it's the 13th track on the album, and then parenthetically called There Is a Light. In between, you know, it's a rock album, but it opens and closes very quietly. The opening prelude, Love is All We Have Left, lyrics like this, you just heard this one, nothing to stop this being the best day ever. Somebody say amen. Amen. Nothing to stop this being the best day ever. Nothing to keep us from where we should be. I wanted the world, but you knew better. And that all we have is immortality. Love and love is all we have left. The only thing that can be kept, love is all we have left. Now, in just a moment, I'm going to show you the closing song of the album. Also, a very quiet, it's kind of a lullaby. That's just not my term. That's what Bono describes it as. He says, I imagine this song as a lullaby for my children. Some of the lyrics go like this. And if the terrors of the night come creeping into your days, and the world comes stealing children from your room, guard your innocence from hallucination, and know that darkness always gathers around the light. There is a light you can't always see. There is a world we can't always be. There is a dark that we shouldn't doubt, and there is a light. Don't let it go out. So the opening prelude and the closing lullaby are about love and light. And it reminds me of the epistle of John, the first epistle, 1 John. You know, it's the writings of John, the Gospel of John, the epistles of John that I've been immersed in for several months now. And so, the album opens and closes with, love is all we have left, there is a light. And if Bono says, love is all we have left and there is a light, I can imagine St. John saying, amen. Love is all we have left. You've just heard that song. Now the closing of the album, the very quiet lullaby, there is a light. You too, there is a light.
And if the terrors of the night creeping into your day, and the world comes stealing children from your room, guard your innocence from hallucination, and know that darkness always gathers around the light. There is a light we can always see. If there is a world we can't always be. If there is a dark that we shouldn't doubt,
there is a light, don't let it go out. When the wind screams and shouts, and the sea is a dragon's tail, and the ship that stole your heart away set sail, when all you've left is leaving, and all you've got is grieving, and all you know is needing. A light you can't always see. If there is a world we can't always be. If there is a dark that we shouldn't doubt, there is a light, don't let it go out. This is a song, a song for someone. Someone like me. I know the world is dumb, but you don't have to be. I've got a question for the child in you before it leaves. Are you tough enough to be kind? Do you know your heart has its own mind? Darkness gathers around the light. Hold on, hold on. There is a light you can't always see. There is a world we can't always be. If there is a dark, not to doubt. There is a light, don't let it go out. This is a song, a song for someone. This is a song, a song for someone, someone like me. Someone like me. Someone like me.
This is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. The darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God. Bono sings, "Love is all we have left, and there is a light." John writes, "God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. God is love, and those who love abide in God." God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all, and that light is love, nothing but love. God, of course, is a mystery. the ultimate transcendent being itself, that which has no contingency. God, of course, is a mystery, but God is also simple. God is a triune fellowship of eternal uncreated love. All creation has its origin in this God of light who is eternal, self-giving love. And everything that is wrong in creation can be healed by this God of light and love. I believe that. So if we say love is all we have left, well, then we can also say there's nothing to stop this being the best day ever. If all we have left is love, we can still say nothing to stop this being the best day ever. This is the witness of all the Christian mystics throughout history, including the two greatest Christian mystics in history, the Apostle John and the Apostle Paul. They say the same thing. On the cross, on that Good Friday, Jesus of Nazareth, stripped naked and nailed to a tree, all he had left was love. I don't know if you can live into that moment, that present moment, what it was like for Jesus. We can only maybe approach it. But remember, Jesus is not an actor in a passion play. He's living this out in the moment. And everything else is gone. Plans are gone. Disciples are gone. Life is gone. Maybe even hope is gone. But love remains. The Father loving the Son. The Son loving the Father. And the Spirit of their love. There is no disruption in the Trinity, even on Good Friday. Love is all that's left. The Father loving the Son loving the Father. And the reality and the energy of their love that is Spirit. And the light of that love shone in the darkness and overcame the darkness. The darkness of sin and of hate. And fear and death, all of the things that put Jesus on that cross. The light shines in the darkness, and the light overcomes the darkness when Jesus prays, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That was the moment when all the darkness, all of the sin in human experience, time and history coalesces into a singularity, a great black hole, and is absorbed by the love of God. Gathered into a single moment where all pride and all greed and all hate and all cruelty and all violence, all sin is gathered into a singularity. It comes to a single point on the darkness of Good Friday. Even the sun refuses to shine. And yet, there's one thing that remains. Love remains. And the sin of the world is swallowed up, absorbed, covered by the love of God. That indeed covers a multitude of sins. In the darkness of Good Friday, when all that was left was love, love was more than enough to save the world. The cross isn't about wrath being satisfied or an offended deity being paid off. It's about love overcoming. It's about a light that cannot be extinguished. Because God is light and in Him is no darkness at all. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God. Now, any person who claims religious experience or practice, which would include everyone in this room, because here you are on a Sunday morning gathered for the practice of worship. Every person who claims any religious experience or practice begins a journey toward the light at some point. There is a beginning. There's a, okay, I'm going to move toward the light. A conversion, a turning. I'm turning to the light. And now I will move through faith and through practice in the direction of the light. Now, this is conversion. It can be sudden, it can be gradual. It can be memorable. It can be something that can never really even be recalled. It's just maybe you grew into that. That doesn't matter. That's irrelevant. The point is there is a beginning for all who claim any kind of religious faith, experience, or practice. There is a beginning of moving toward the light. But it is necessarily nothing more than a beginning point, a kindergarten point. Necessarily, it is an immature point because you have to start somewhere. And you don't get to start at the end. You have to start at the beginning. It's a beginning, almost always, with a lot of black and white, with a lot of lines, a lot of rules, a lot of dualism, a lot of us versus them. That's just how it almost always begins for everyone. It's probably necessary. Probably you just can't start in a PhD program. You got to start in kindergarten. But if we stay on the journey long enough, I'm talking about this journey toward the light. If we stay on the journey long enough, and it is a long journey, it's not a 6-week program. It's not 4 years of college. It's a lifetime, and maybe longer. If we stay on the journey long enough, we move toward God. We draw near to God. Toward the God who is light and in whom is no darkness at all. As we move deeper and deeper into the light of God, so we move. Now, when we first start, there's shadows and there's black and white and there's misapprehension and there's assumptions and there's a lot of shadows. But we move. We stay on the journey. We move toward the light. And as we move deeper and deeper into the light of God, what do we find? Well, ultimately, love and nothing but love. That's all we find there. Because God is love. Love plus nothing. Now, early in the journey, it's hard to accept that. So maybe you can't accept that. Okay. I hope you remember this someday. As we move deeper and deeper into the light, what do we find? Love, nothing but love, because God is love, love plus nothing. As my friend Brad Jerzak says, God is love without remainder. Now, the Apostle John says this is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ. That's what he says. John says, this is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ. That's in his introduction to his epistle. God is light and God is love. I think of the little 5-chapter book of 1 John as both the most mystical and most mature theology in the New Testament. Romans has its place, again, of course, inspired and very lofty and reaches great heights, and yet I think there is a mystic simplicity that tends toward a deeper maturity found in 1 John. I've been reading 1 John over and over, and I think I can sum it up in a sentence if I have to. To walk in the light is to walk in love, and to abide in love is to abide in God. Read the whole book, read all 5 chapters, but I think that's a fair summary if one must attempt to summarize a book of the Bible in one sentence. To walk in the light is to walk in love, and to abide in love is to abide in God. And John himself says that this is the distillation of the message we have heard from Jesus Christ. John is just saying, you know, I've been meditating on what we heard it from Jesus. What our hands handled and our ears have heard and our eyes have seen from Jesus. And how do I sum it up for you? I want to tell you this. God is light and there's no darkness in him. God is love, and the one that abides in love abides in God. This is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ. The universe is finite. This plane of our existence, the universe, is finite. It had a beginning. We know pretty accurately the beginning. 13.8 billion years ago, plus or minus 0.04%. From what we can tell through the same physics that identify the beginning of the universe, we call it the Big Bang in science, call it Genesis in theology. The same science, the same physics that allows us to identify that it began 13.8 billion years ago also indicates that the universe will end. We don't have a precise date. It varies wildly. Some even suggest that it could be, you know, 100 trillion years, which is a long time. But the point is, it's finite. It had a beginning and it will have an end. The universe is not infinite. The universe is finite. What is infinite? God's love is infinite. It's the love of God that gives the hope of eternal life, which I guess is the third theme that John gives us, both in his gospel and in his epistle. God is light. God is love. And this is the promise God has made unto us. Eternal life. Not finite life, infinite life. Life without end. The Apostle Paul says that love never ends. Love never ends. Everything else ends. Love doesn't end. In the beginning, there was love. It's why God said, let there be. And what he said was, let there be light. In the beginning, there was love. And at the end of all things, there is still love. Because love never ends. The universe ends. God's love doesn't end. So when the last star burns out, God's love will be there for whatever comes after. You know, after a few 100 trillion years, we might say, we need a remodel. God's love is there for whatever comes after. Eternal life is found only in the eternal love of God. I hear about these rich folks that are into cryogenics. They're freezing themselves at death, putting themselves in a freezer waiting for science to catch up so that they can be brought back to life. Well, isn't that nice? Let me tell you something. Eternal life is not found in your freezer. Frozen pizzas are found in your freezer. Eternal life is found in the infinite love of God. So don't stop looking for eternal life in your freezer. It's got to be here somewhere. The ancient Hebrew concept of death is the land where all is forgotten. One of the psalmists says, I am forgotten as a dead man, out of mind, useless as a broken pot. This is the concept of Sheol. Sheol is the place of insubstantial shades where everything is forgotten and no one is remembered. For the Jewish psalmist, death was descent into the state of forgotten non-being. Here in the land of the living, we are all destined to be forgotten. Someday I'll die. And who will remember me? Well, I think, you know, some of my friends will. I think you might. If you outlive me. You might remember. Oh, yeah, I remember that guy. Yeah, he used to preach sermons on Sunday morning out there in St. Joe. Wrote some books, maybe. I don't know. I'm sure my children will remember me. I'm confident my grandchildren, I've got seven now, I think they'll remember me. Great-grandchildren, I don't have any. Maybe I will, probably will, but will they remember me? I remember two of my great-grandparents, one just very vaguely, and one fairly well. But the others, I never met them. I never encountered them. I can't tell you their names. We're all going to be forgotten, you know, in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 generations. It'll be as if you were never here. Oh, this is a chipper, uplifting sermon today. Just hold on. I'm going to get there, but I've got to paint the reality of the picture here. You're going to be forgotten. In a scandalously short amount of time. I mean, you spend all your time living, 70, 80 years, and then in about the same amount of time that you did your living, you're forgotten. And that's, well, okay, live to be 120, you'll be forgotten 120. You know, and this, by the way, this is one of the great themes of books like Ecclesiastes, Job, the Psalms. All that are living are destined to be forgotten. But I believe I'll be remembered by God. You say you believe that? I do believe that. Why do I believe that? Well, I believe that God loves me. And we remember who we love. God's memory doesn't fail, and God's love doesn't end. Oh. So if God remembers what God loves, then even though I'm forgotten by everybody else, God remembers. And if God remembers, I believe God can remember. If God remembers, He can remember. In Christian theology, we call it resurrection. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God. All right, I've got a thought experiment for you. This one does not involve time travel. Usually my thought experiments involve time travel. This one does not. I want you just to imagine something. I'm going to tell you what I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine a particular state. I want you to imagine that God had no disposition toward you other than unconditional, unalterable, unending love. Just pretend. Just for a moment, just pretend it's true. That God's attitude, God's disposition, God's thoughts toward you are nothing but unconditional, unconditional. It's not based on anything. Unalterable. It can't be changed. Unending. It'll never come to an end. Just play along. Maybe if it helps, close your eyes. Imagine, what if God had nothing for you, no attitude, no disposition towards you other than unconditional, unalterable, unending love? Pretend that God has infinite love for you. Just pretend. Think about, okay. God has nothing but, it's unconditional, it's unalterable, it's unending, just love. Think about that. How does that make you feel? What does that do for you? How does that change you? Pretending that God has nothing but unconditional, unalterable, unending love for you. And now, stop pretending and believe. Believe. Believe it. Believe it because it's true. This is the witness of the apostles Paul and John. This is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ. I know the world is done, but you don't have to be. And this is a song for someone. Someone like me. Someone like you. Amen. Amen. If you want to applaud, yeah. Stand with me. Father, I pray that from this eternal community of love, of being, consciousness, of bliss, of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this eternal triune phenomenon of self-giving love, from which the Spirit of love, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God proceeds, I ask that Holy Spirit would come and help us know, help each person know here today how deeply they are loved by you. That it's not a fallacy when I say that, God, you love each person here unconditionally, unalterably, unendingly. That your love toward them never fails, it never ends. And that our hope of eternal life, eternal well-being, is in that love. God, I thank you for this message that we have heard from your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us to be open to that message, to that light, and to that love. In Jesus' name, amen.